What's going on, everyone? Let's take a look at the Human Genome Project. We touched on this in the last video that I made about BGI Group. Let's go and take a look at what this is all about. So the Human Genome Project was an international scientific research project with the goal of determining the base pairs that make up human DNA and of identifying and mapping all of the genes of the human genome from both a physical and a functional standpoint. It remains the world's largest collaborative biological project. Planning started after the idea was picked up in 1984 by the U.S. government. The project formally launched in 1990 and was declared complete on April 14, 2003. Level complete genome was achieved in, that's right, May of this year. Funding came from the American government through the National Institutes of Health, or the NIH, as well as numerous other groups from around the world. A parallel project was conducted outside the government by the Celera Corporation, or Celera Genomics, which was formally launched in 1998. Most of the government-sponsored sequencing was performed in the 20 universities and research centers in the United States, the United Kingdom, Japan, France, Germany, India, and China. Now, in May 1985, Robert Steinsheimer organized a workshop at the University of California, Santa Cruz, to discuss sequencing the human genome, but for a number of reasons, the NIH was uninterested in pursuing the proposal. The following March, the Santa Fe workshop was organized by Charles DeLisi and David Smith of the Department of Energy's Office and Health of Environmental Research, or OHER. At the same time, Renato Delbecco proposed whole genome sequencing in an essay in Science. James Watson followed 2 months later with a workshop held at the Cold Spring Harbor Laboratory. Thus, the idea for obtaining a reference sequence had three independent origins. Sinsheimer, Dulbecco, and DeLisi, with DeLisi ultimately being the one whose actions launched the project. So let's take a look at these three real quick. We have Robert L. Sinsheimer, and he served as chairman of Caltech's Division of Biology for 9 years, from 1968 to 1977, and later became chancellor of the University of California at Santa Cruz. He joins Caltech faculty as a professor of biophysics in 1957 and continues his work on isolating the virus PHIX-174, work with Arthur Kornberg of Stanford on in vitro synthesis of DNA. He receives his California Scientist of the Year Award in 1968 and is elected that year to the National Academy of Sciences. Next, we have Dulbecco, who was born in Catanzaro, southern Italy, but spent his childhood and grew up in Liguria, the coastal city, Imperia. He graduated from high school at 16, then moved to the University of Turin. Despite a strong interest in mathematics and physics, he decided to study medicine. In 1936, he was called up for military service as a medical officer, and later in 1938 was discharged. After the war, he resumed his work at Levi's laboratory, but soon he moved together with Levi Montalcini to the U.S., where at Indiana University, he worked with Salvador Luria on bacteriophages. Now, as many Italian scientists, Dulbecco did not actually have a PhD because it was non-existent in the Italian higher education system until it was introduced later in 1980. Now we have DeLisi. We have Charles Peter DeLisi, born December 9th, 1941. He's an American biomedical scientist and the Metcalf Professor of Science and Engineering at Boston University. In 1986, as director of the U.S. Department of Energy's DOE, Health and Environmental Research Programs, DeLisi and his advisors proposed, planned, and defended before the White House, Office of Management and Budget, and the Congress, the Human Genome Project. The proposal created a storm of controversy, but received strong support from Alvin Trivelpiece, who was head of the DOE's Office of Science, and William Flynn Martin, the Deputy Secretary of Energy. In the spring of 1987, shortly before leaving the DOE, DeLisi established an ethical studies component of the project. The goal was to set aside 3 to 5% of the funding in order to engage the best minds in the humanities and social sciences to develop a body of thought that would inform decisions about the development and deployment of the radically new technologies destined to emerge from the completion of the project. In addition to the medical and scientific advances engendered by the Human Genome Project, it and its progeny have had a profound effect on the sociology and culture of cell biology. The computer science community in particular moved with extraordinary dexterity into cell biology, transforming the field and creating a record of discovery destined to provide material for a remarkable story in the sociology of late 20th and early 21st century science. The project was not able to sequence all of the DNA found in human cells. It was sequenced only euchromatic regions of the genome, which make up 92.1% of the human genome. The other regions, called heterochromatic, are found in centromeres and telomeres, and were not sequenced under the project. Now, the Human Genome Project was declared complete in April of 2003. An initial rough draft of the human genome was available in June 2000, and by February 2001, a working draft had been completed and published following the final sequencing mapping of the human genome on April 14, 2003. In March 2009, the Genome Reference Consortium released a more accurate version of the human genome, but that still left more than 300 gaps, while 160 such gaps remained in 2015. Though in May 2020, the GRC reported 79 unresolved gaps, accounting for as much as 5% of the human genome. So by this point in time, they had already mapped out 95% of the human genome. Months later, the application of new long-range sequencing techniques and a homozygous cell line in which both copies of each chromosome are identical led to the first telomere-to-telomere, truly complete sequence of a human chromosome, the X chromosome. In 2021, that's, you know, this year, it was reported that the telomere-to-telomere, T2T, consortium had filled in all of the gaps. Thus, there came into existence a complete human genome with almost no gaps, but it still had 5 gaps in ribosomal DNA. In May of this year, not long ago, those last 5 rDNA gaps were found, and published as version 1.1. This sequence does not contain the Y chromosome, which causes the embryo to become male, because only duplicated male sperm with X chromosome was present. About 0.3% of this sequence proved difficult to check for quality, and thus contains errors which are being fixed, likely still to this day. So what now? Along with the identifying of all approximately 20,000 to 25,000 genes in the human genome, estimated at between 80,000 and 140,000 at the start of the project, the Human Genome Project also sought to address the ethical, legal, and social issues that were created by the onset of the project. For that, the Ethical, Legal, and Social Implications, or ELSI, program was founded in 1990. 5% of the annual budget was allocated to address the ELSI arising from the project. This budget started at approximately $1.57 million in the year 1990, but increased to approximately $18 million in the year 2014. While as the project may offer significant benefits to medicine and scientific research, some authors have emphasized the need to address the potential social consequences of mapping the human genome. So they're about to finish. Again, they have less than 1% to go, and then they will have a legit human genome with no errors. So I just wanted to give you some backstory on that, and I'll continue on here in a little bit.